In this session, we are going to discuss about a new chapter, that is carbon and its compounds. First of all, let us revise what you have learned about carbon in class 9. You know that in a periodic table, carbon is placed on the right side. That means carbon is a non-metal. Now, what is the atomic number of carbon? Atomic number of carbon is 6. Then what will be its electronic configuration? It will be 2, 4. You see, in the first shell, the maximum number of electrons that can be accommodated is 2. So, in the first shell, that is in the K shell, 2 electrons are placed. Then the remaining 4 electrons are occupied in the second shell, that is in the valence shell. That's why the electronic configuration of carbon is 2, 4. Now, in the last chapter, that is in the chapter metals and nonmetals, we have discussed about ionic compounds. Now, what about the valencies of metals? In the last chapter, we have seen that metals have valencies of 1, 2 or 3. And nonmetals have the valence electrons, the number of valence electrons in the outermost shell, that is 5, 6 or 7. So, usually in a chemical reaction, a metal loses the valence electrons to form cations, to form positive ions. What about nonmetals? Nonmetals accept the electrons to become anions or to become negative ions. That's why we say that metals are electropositive and nonmetals are electronegative. Metals give the electron and nonmetals accept the electron. And when the electrons are transferred from metal to a nonmetal, the compound formed is called ionic compound. That is what we have learned in the previous chapter. Now let us discuss about carbon. You see, the electronic configuration of carbon is 2, 4. So, its valence electron, the number of electrons in the outermost shell is 4. Now, let us see what happens when carbon accepts 4 electrons to get the octet configuration or noble gas configuration. You see, the electronic configuration is 2, 4. So, when it accepts 4 electrons, its octet is completed. That means it will have 8 electrons in the outermost shell, but it is not possible. Why? Why? Because carbon has 6 protons in the nucleus. You know that the atomic number of carbon is 6. That means carbon has 6 electrons in the orbits and 6 protons in the nucleus. And proton has a positive charge and electron has negative charge. You know that. So the number of protons in the nucleus of carbon is 6. Now if carbon accepts 4 more electrons, how many electrons will be there in this atom? In the carbon atom, there will be 10 electrons. But how many protons are there? Only 6 protons are there in the nucleus. So, it is not possible for 6 protons or a nucleus with 6 protons to hold on to 10 electrons. So, carbon cannot accept 4 more electrons. Now, let us see what happens if carbon loses 4 electrons. You see, if carbon loses the outermost 4 electrons, it can get the nearest noble gas configuration, that is helium configuration. But whether, let us see whether carbon can lose that 4 electrons. Actually, carbon cannot lose that 4 electrons. Why? Because a large amount of energy is required to remove the outermost 4 electrons. So, carbon cannot accept 4 electrons to get noble gas configuration. At the same time, carbon cannot lose the 4 electrons to get the or to reach the nearest noble gas configuration. Then how carbon combines with other elements? You see, carbon shares their electrons. Carbon shares their electrons. You see, in ionic compounds, electrons were transferred from metal to a non-metal. But here, carbon cannot give or accept electron, but carbon shares electron. Not only carbon, there are many other elements, you know, share electrons to form molecule. Now, let us start with hydrogen. You know the atomic number of hydrogen, that is 1. That means hydrogen will have 1 electron in the outermost shell. Hydrogen has only 1 shell and that 1 electron is placed in the first shell or K shell. That means the electronic configuration of helium, that is the nearest noble gas close to that of hydrogen. To get the nearest noble gas configuration of helium, how many electrons is needed? You know that 1 more is needed. If hydrogen gets 1 more electron, it can get the nearest noble gas configuration. But hydrogen has only one electron. Then what happens here? You see, two hydrogen atoms share their electron each other and they form a hydrogen molecule as shown here. You see, hydrogen has only one electron. So, there will be two hydrogen atoms, they share their electron to form a molecule as shown here and they form a hydrogen molecule. You see, how many pairs of electrons are shared here? One pair, that is two electrons, that means one pair. One pair of electron is shared here. So, we say that the bond formed in a hydrogen molecule is a single bond. Now, let us take the example of oxygen. You know that atomic number of oxygen is 8. What will be its electronic configuration? 2, 6. So, it will have 6 electrons in the outermost shell. So, how many electrons are needed to get the noble gas configuration? It requires 2 more. If it gets 2 more electrons, the valence electrons will become 8. That means that it will be close to the neon configuration. So, is it possible for oxygen to get 2 more electrons? Yes. How? Oxygen atom combine or share 2 electrons with other oxygen atom. Actually, an oxygen atom has 6 electrons in the outermost shell. Then there will be 2 oxygen atoms coming closer and they share 2 pairs of electrons between them and it forms oxygen molecule. You see, now the first oxygen that will have 8 electrons and the second one also will have 8 electrons by sharing 2 pairs of electrons. You see, now how many pairs of electrons are shared here? 4 electrons, that means 2 pairs of electrons are shared here. So, the bond formed between oxygen atoms in an oxygen molecule, that will be a double bond. Now, let us discuss about nitrogen. You know that atomic number of nitrogen is 7. What will be its electronic configuration? It will be 2, 5. So, how many electrons will be there in the valence shell? The outermost shell, it will have 5 electrons. How many electrons are needed more to get the octet configuration? It requires 3 more. Then what happens here? 2 nitrogen atoms come closer and they share their 3 electrons with each other. First nitrogen atom will have 8 electrons and the second also will have 8 electrons in the outermost shell. That means here 6 electrons are shared. That is 3 pairs are shared. So the bond formed between nitrogen will be a triple bond. Now let us discuss about the smallest or the simplest carbon compound, methane. Its molecular formula is CH4. Now let us see how is a methane molecule is formed here. You see, carbon has 4 electrons in the outermost shell. So each electron will be shared with each hydrogen atom. And here you can see that carbon acquires 8 electrons in the valence shell. At the same time, hydrogen also get 2 electrons in the outermost shell. That is how a methane is formed. Now, this type of compounds formed by sharing of electrons that are called covalent compounds. You see, in the last chapter we discussed about ionic compounds. How is ionic compound formed? It is by the transfer of electrons from metal to non-metal. But here the electrons are shared between non-metals. Isn't it? Here the sharing of electrons is taking place. That is how a covalent compound is formed. Now, let us discuss about some of the properties of these covalent compounds. Usually, covalent compounds will have low melting point and boiling point. Why? Because the intermolecular force of attraction is very weak in covalent compound. And they do not conduct electricity. Why? Because they do not form any ions. You see, in this chemical reaction, there is no ions or charged particles are formed. Because they share the electrons, unlike ionic compounds. Ionic compounds conduct electricity in molten state and in solution. We have just seen that. Why? Because their charged particles or ions are formed. Here there is no ions are formed. So, they are bad conductors of electricity. Now, let us discuss about the allotropes of carbon. You see, carbon can exist in nature in different forms. They are called allotropes. Now, the allotropes of carbon, they are first one diamond, then graphite, and third one fullerene. These are the 3 allotropic forms of carbon. Now let us discuss about the structure of these allotropes. In diamond, each carbon atom is bonded with other 4 carbon atoms and it forms a structure as shown here. Now the next one, in graphite. In graphite, each carbon is bonded with other three carbons. But among these three carbon, one bond will be a double bond. And the structure is as shown here. And the final one is fullerene. Here carbon atoms are arranged in the shape of a football. You see, the different structures of these allotropes give different properties or physical properties for all these allotropes. But their chemical properties remain the same. These different structures provide different physical properties for all these allotropes. We have seen the physical properties of diamond and graphite in the previous chapter. You see, diamond, which is the hardest substance existing in nature. But what about graphite? Graphite is very soft and smooth. The difference in physical properties of these allotropes are due to the different structures of these allotropes. Carbon forms large number of compounds by combining with other carbon atoms and with other elements. You see, there are millions and millions of compounds exist in nature, which includes carbon. So why such large number of compounds are formed by carbon? That is we are going to discuss in this topic now. It is because of two reasons. The first one is catenation. What do you mean by catenation? Catenation means carbon can combine with other carbon atoms to form long chain of carbons or branched chain of carbons, or it can also form ring structures. This is known as catenation. So it is the ability of carbon to form bonds with other carbon atoms. Next one is tetravalency. We know that carbon has a valency of 4. So carbon atom is capable of bonding with other carbon atoms or other atoms of monovalent elements. In this chapter, the carbon compounds are divided into two categories. The first one is saturated carbon compounds. The other one is unsaturated carbon compounds. Let us see what is saturated carbon compounds. If the bond formed in carbon compounds is single bond, we say that the compounds are saturated. Now, if the bond formed in the carbon compounds are double bond or triple bond, we say that that is unsaturated carbon compounds. So carbon compounds are of two types, saturated and unsaturated. Saturated means if single bond is present, that is called saturated. If double bond or triple bond is present, that is called unsaturated. If a carbon compound contains only carbon and hydrogen, those compounds are called hydrocarbons. Okay, so hydrocarbons will have only carbon and hydrogen. In a hydrocarbon, if single bond is present, those compounds are called alkane. If double bond is present, that hydrocarbons are called alkene. And if there is a triple bond, the compound is called alkynes. So what is alkane, alkene and alkyne? You see, alkane means hydrocarbons with single bond. See the spelling, alkane, ane, A-N-E, it is the last three letters, alkane. So in alkane, single bond is present. In alkene, in, double bond is present. And in alkyne, Y-N-E, triple bond is present. So what are alkane, alkene and alkyne? See, these are the hydrocarbons with single bond, double bond and triple bond respectively.